Looked good.
It was beautiful. Okay,
seat
change.
Good job, ladies. Alright, stand by, ladies.
I'm recording.
You ready now?
Yep.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Morning. Okay, for those that did not work February, you may wonder why you're seeing me and not Dave. Dave is the new temporary finance director interim. So, thanks, I didn't even notice that. It's habit nowadays, unfortunately. So yes, Dave is the interim finance director right now, so that makes me the interim clerk. So that means you're stuck with me this time and not Dave. Hopefully, this is the last election for the year, so somebody else will be here to help run this next time around in February next year. So I'm just here to talk about the April election inspector training. We're gonna go over a little bit of things today. We're gonna go over new poll workers, lack of recent court decisions, which is good, COVID-19, the current election, absentee voting, election observer, and just review of other materials. Okay. Yeah, if you have any phones on, just make sure they're on silent. So, all right. So for new poll workers, we had about 130 just people in general sign up to work polls. That includes both the polling and central count. If there is any new poll workers, you guys just need to make sure you stop at HR to either fill out your paperwork to get paid or fill out your paperwork to not get paid. But either way, we need something done from you. Like I said, if you don't want to get paid, you still have to fill out the declination of pay, which will be available on the HR, and they can help you with all that. So COVID-19 is still here, and it still exists, unfortunately. For the past few elections, we've still seen about 80% of the people voting in absentee voting versus in-person. We started to see a lack of response from some of the people we mail ballots to, so I don't know if that is because they want to vote in person or they're just tired with the whole election process. I don't know either way yet. So I guess on Tuesday we're going to find out for sure whether it's they're tired of it or they just want to vote in person. We're going to have the same safety protocols that we've had in place in the past. People should still be wearing their mask. Unfortunately, just remember we can't require voters to wear their mask, but we highly encourage them to wear their mask. Obviously, for you guys, we're going to have masks available again if you want to. Otherwise, you can wear whatever ones you were currently wearing. We're also going to have some plastic shields like we have in the past. So for this current election, we're going to have about six things on the ballots. There were sample ballots out there for you if you needed them. If not, you can grab one out on the way. State Superintendent of Public Instruction, there's two people running and you can only vote for one. There's also the Rock County Circuit Court Judge Branch 5, vote for one. I do believe there's only one person running for that. And Janesville City Council member, you can vote up to four, and I do believe there's six running for that. Depending on where you're working, you're gonna either have the Janesville School District or the Milton School District, and they're gonna be vote for three or vote for four, depending on where you're at. Janesville's gonna be vote for three, Milton School District's gonna be vote for four. The last thing on the ballot is a Rock County Accept Affordable Care Act referendum. Just to let you know, we'll send a, I don't know how you want to word it, but referendums are usually written by lawyers. So it's going to be kind of a paragraph overview on exactly what that means in a little bit more simpler terms. Just keep in mind, you're not allowed to help them figure out what it means. You just can give them the sheet and say, here you go. Keep in mind, this is also a non-binding referendum if anybody asks. So what that means is we're just encouraging Rock County to, actually, we're encouraging the state to, but it really doesn't matter how you guys vote or how it's voted. It will be up to the legislature to actually do it. So it is non-binding. So even if it does pass, it doesn't really mean anything. You can tell them it's non-binding, yes. So the tally slips are the same that you guys have been dealing with since COVID started. So I think that would have been March or April of last year. Some of you guys are used to the only standard white, yellow, pink, and orange. Some of them, like the Job Center, the old Edison School, used to have a lot more. But you're going to see some really odd colors that you're not used to. So if you haven't worked in a few elections, you're going to see also gray, purple, and green on some of these ballots. Keep in mind the ballots are not full colored, they're just the colored stripe anymore. So when you're looking at the ballots, sometimes when we went to more colors, it's been a little bit harder to tell, but it should be separated pretty well that some of the colors that might look alike to some people are not going to be next to each other. We did try to put a little bit of effort into that to make sure we didn't do that. So as of 3/29, which was a couple days ago, we've issued over 4,800 ballots. As of 3/29 also, we only got back 1,700 as of so far. I think I checked yesterday and we're closer to 2,000. And we kind of saw this in the previous election in February where everybody brought them in at the last minute or mailed them at the last minute. So I would assume by the time we actually do absentee counting, the number is probably going to be closer to 2,500. But still, either way, it's a lot lower than what we personally expected. We expected much bigger numbers absentee, considering there's a city council race with people that we're going to get new council members in Janesville. There's no way around it. So we thought that was really going to drive it, but it really hasn't yet. But maybe we'll see that on Tuesday. Absentee ballots, like in the past, are going to be processed here at City Hall. Just a reminder, you guys did a really good job at this last time. If you receive a walk-in absentee ballot, call our office right away. We may or may not pick it up right away. We're going to have some runners that start at 6 to help pick these up. So if you get a call or if you get a ballot at about 1, don't be surprised if we don't come right away. But we'll get them before it gets too late and the absentee can count those. But we'll get them counted right away, so just give us a call. And just keep in mind when, like I said, this may be more of a problem than you've traditionally seen, but because a lot of voters did sign up for indefinitely confined back in last year, and some of them are coming to our office. We're getting it straightened out on our end, but if people come to the polls on election day, they're going to be voted as a, you know, received ballot. So you're going to want to really pay attention because you're going to run into this, like I said, I think a lot more than what you have in the past. So if you get one that it says marked received on our end, you're going to want to make sure you call our office and ask them, did we get that ballot back? You know, we do make mistakes like everybody does. We could have potentially scanned a wrong ballot, but it is scanned, so it's usually not an issue. But give us a call because there's still a possibility that that person truly did not send their ballot back, and we can let them vote in person. So if they're going to vote in person and they've supposedly received the ballot and returned it, we'd have to have them vote provisionally, but we can hopefully get that straightened out before it comes down to that. But so just make sure you tell your poll workers that to really pay attention to that. I think that's, like I said, going to be a bigger problem than what you guys have dealt with in the past, because I think before we used to get one or two calls, maybe, on an election, but with the big switch, I could see us getting a lot more calls. So just really pay attention when you're doing that, if it says absentee ballot issued or absentee ballots received next to somebody. I know in the last couple elections, it's only happened once, but we've actually had somebody sign right over absentee ballot received. So that means that we supposedly received a ballot. We went back and looked, and we had a ballot. So just make sure you guys are paying extra attention because that did happen once. So this is what it kind of looks like when you're looking at the things. If you can see the yellow highlight, if it says absentee ballot issued and then it says not returned, you can have them vote. You're still going to want to ask them, though, if they did return their ballots, because we do print these out on Friday. That way you guys have them from Saturday and Sunday to start prepping. So we legally have to accept any ballots up until 8 o'clock on election night. So there's a possibility that could change. So anytime you would see absentee ballot issues, always, always, always tell your poll workers to ask to be sure that they didn't return that. Because sometimes what will happen is people go into WISP vote and they really don't understand the process. And you know, we may not mark it as received because we received it on election day and we haven't made the process yet, so they'll think, oh, I gotta come in to vote, but really that we have the ballot sitting there, we just haven't marked it as received yet because we just got it. So when you get into this one and this is absentee ballots returned, you really have to pay attention because that means that we've got a ballot back. So just make sure if Christine was to come in to vote today, that you really, really ask Christine what was going on and give us a call, because it looks like we received a ballot on our end. So in this case, more than likely Christine would not be able to vote, but if she was insistent, she would have to vote provisionally because we're not quite sure at this point what's going on. Observers, I don't know what kind of observers you're gonna get and not gonna get, but my guess is you may get a few just because the political climate we're in nowadays. Just keep in mind, all observers have to register with the chief election inspector. You know, observers have the right to view the process, but they don't have the right to interfere with the process. So keep that in mind. They can watch, they can ask questions by no means, but they shouldn't be hovering over you watching the process slowing you down or anything like that. They still have to keep a minimum of 6 feet away. And I would encourage you to provide them with a copy of the rules. The rules are usually in the chief inspector's briefcase. So if you ever have any questions with the Zerbers, give us a holler. We can help you out. Usually we only see them in the presidential races, but with everything going on now, I wouldn't be surprised if you get some of the Zerbers. Keep in mind, as a chief inspector, for the few of you that are here that are chief inspectors, you do have the right to actually boot them out of the polling place. There's a form you have to fill out. But you can, if they feel like they're interfering or, you know, not social distancing or doing whatever else they wanted or think they can do, but they can't, don't be afraid to say, hey, you need to leave and give them the form. Keep in mind, they always still have to follow the COVID-19 safety procedures. And don't be afraid to designate an area in the polling place for the observers. Like I said, I don't think this is going to be a huge issue, but we may see somebody. Normally on this election, I probably wouldn't say don't even bother worrying about it, but once again, you may be involved, and then don't be afraid to say, you know what, the election observers are just going to be sitting here next to this table. They can see everything they need to from there. Jerry?
Are observers
I do believe observers, we can require them to wear a mask. I do believe. But I can follow up. But I think that's what Dave said in November when we were starting to see a lot of observers. So the question was, is can we force observers to wear a mask? And I think the question and the answer is yes. So voter ID, voters are still required to show identification in order to vote. There's an exhaustive list that are acceptable forms. There's also gonna be a handout in the briefcases. Nothing has changed, so don't be alarmed, and I'm just letting you guys know, so if it's been a while since you worked. But yes, voter ID is still in effect. Keep in mind, the voter is supposed to say it, show it, and sign it. So what that really means is before you see their ID, they really should be saying it. So have them say their name, say their address, and then look at their ID, because that's the way it's supposed to be done. And then they're gonna obviously sign the poll book. So the voter signs the green book in red ink. That way it's easy to tell when we have a voter. If you use black ink, it's not a huge deal, but it does make it a little bit harder for us just to check at the end of the night or when we're actually doing the voting, because red sticks out so much better. Voter ID. Election inspectors need to look at the photo ID and determine if it's reasonable, the person. This is really hard nowadays with masks. So you just use your best judgment, look at their eyes, do what you can. But you should really be able to tell roughly, even with a mask on, if it's the voter or not. Certain IDs are acceptable, driver's license, you know, we're all used to all those that are acceptable, federal IDs, military IDs, you know, all those are acceptable. Just keep in mind, if they do expire, they need to be expired less than November 3rd of 2020. So what that means is if an ID expires November 4th of 2020, we can take it. If it would expire November 2nd, 2020, we cannot take it. It's a little unique rule that I think about is because that number changes. The number is based on the last general election. So the last general election for us was November. So if you worked before November, you'd wonder, used to be 2018. So that'll be into effect until the next general election, which is 22, which is really odd because sometimes your ID can be expired a month and it won't work, but other times it can be expired a year and a half ago and it will work. So just really odd. So just make sure you note that anything that's expired after November 3rd, we can take. So what will happen if the voter doesn't have an ID? They should really go home to get their ID. It makes their life easier and it makes our life easier. Just have them go home. But what happens, you know, I guess if they come in at 7:50 and they want to vote, then they do have the right to vote provisionally. The chief inspectors are going to be the one that wants to handle that, but I would highly encourage you just to have them go get their ID if they have the time for it. Because if somebody votes provisionally, it doesn't mean that we'll just count their ballot, you know, whenever. They actually have to come down to City Hall by Friday at 4 o'clock to give us their documentation. Usually by then, if the race is already determined, a lot of them don't show up to show us their ID. Because, you know, the voter that they wanted or the candidate they wanted either really won or didn't win, and their one vote isn't going to matter. So I really just encourage you to come and vote or come to have them go get their ID and have no provisional ballots. But that is optional to make sure somebody does get the right to vote. Like I said, if the voter wants to vote provisionally, the chief inspectors have to go through that process. It's by no means complicated, but it is a little unique because they have to sign stuff and you have to put their ballot in an envelope, and then you have to put the envelope in an envelope because that's just what we do in Wisconsin. Correct. The question was, is do they get a tally slip number? And the answer is no, because that would throw your numbers off at the end of the night. Because if you had 500 voters and you had one provisional, your machine's going to say 499. And if you gave that provisional voter, your tally slips would say 500. So there's voter IDs. I don't think we have any confidential voters that are going to be showing up to the polling place, but that's always subject to change. We do have a couple confidential voters in Janesville, but they did get an absentee ballot, so you shouldn't see them again. But basically, all confidential voters are exempt from showing photo ID. An example why a confidential voter might exist is if it's a domestic abuse and they don't want the abuser to know where the person's living, and they would be exempt from showing their ID. So basically, we would issue them a confidential ID that would just have their number on there. That way you know it's the right person. But we haven't issued an ID, so you should be good to go. I don't expect anybody to be coming in the next couple days. But if they have the right to come in on Monday and ask for it, we're going to give it to them. But you shouldn't see it. So they don't need to state their name. They don't need to state their address. But they still may sign the poll book. And although that somewhat makes sense, it doesn't make sense because they're writing their name on there. So, but at least it won't have their name and address. So make sure they still sign their poll book. But like I said, you shouldn't run into this at all. The question was, is when the voter shows their ID, do both election inspectors have to view the ID? And I would say that only really one of them needs to, just to be sure. But if there's ever a doubt, don't be afraid to work with that other person to make sure, because especially with masks nowadays, it's a little more tricky. But no, when we do voting at the window, we only have one person check their ID. And that would be the person issuing them the ballot. So I don't see why you'd have to have both of them. But please, please encourage them to work together if there's ever a doubt. Greg? The question is, can you ask them, the voter, to pull their mask down? Yeah, I mean, you can do that. I would, you know, encourage you to, as much as you can, not do that. But I would rather have the right to know that you're giving somebody the correct ballot and making sure that's the right person to have that ballot. But obviously, then, as on that side note of that, is if there's other people around them kind of piling up because there is a delay, I would kind of encourage you to maximize the space as much as you can to limit the possibility, because, you know, obviously with COVID, I don't want perfect world. I want nobody to get COVID because they come to vote, or any of my workers get COVID because they come to vote. So that's fine. But like I said, just make sure you maintain space as much as you can. So if there's kind of a line building up, you may want to just tell the line to take a step back so they can do it. So, all right. So election day, 7 a.m., everything's ready to go. You need to have somebody come out and say, hear ye, the polls are now open. Some people really get into this, so feel free to send your most vocal person, or maybe somebody that has a little bit of an acting background or something that wants to get the old English in there too or something. So, but make sure at 7 o'clock somebody goes out and says that. Question? So the question was, is what I understand is prior in the past, but I don't know for sure, there used to be, the police would deliver the ballots at about 7 o'clock. Escort the poll workers at 7 o'clock with the sirens blaring to let people know that the polls were open. And then at the end of the night, at 8 o'clock, they would escort then the ballots back to City Hall. And then people would kind of have a better idea that the polls were open and the polls were closed. I don't know. That's a very good question. That's something we could look at if, you know, if the field. I mean, it kind of would be unique and interesting, definitely. But
for so many people. Huh. It really ticks them off that there's so many people.
Yeah. So that's definitely something we could look at doing, or trying to just raise awareness in other ways. But yeah, that's interesting. And if that's true, that is kind of an actual cool thing that they used to do. But obviously, it's before my time, too. So, but definitely. So, as part of opening the polls, you're going to want to make sure the express vote is open. Although the express votes are a lot lighter than it is, that they used to be, and you can actually, I'll carry two or three of them at a time in the bag. I'd still encourage you guys to have two people lift the machine. By no means is it heavy, but just by the off chance somebody would drop it or they'd hurt their back, I'd feel bad. So just have two people lift the machine. Just make sure you position the machine to protect the privacy. I know that's kind of hard in certain places like Sears because it's so massive. So just do your best to put it against a wall or something like that so people can still have privacy. Question? I can ask that question again. The question was, is Sears going to have all the lights working right away at 7? I'll ask again. I'm not going to be the one that goes out to the mall to get the keys and stuff, but I'll ask the person to follow up with that again. So I thought I was under the impression last time when I asked him that there's a switch that you guys could flip and it turned on, but so. So I'll follow up to see if maybe there's a separate electrical box over there somewhere for that side. But yeah, I mean, that's up to the poll workers. You guys have every right to do whatever you want. You guys are in charge. I would just encourage you not to go back too far just because if people are maybe hard of walking, I don't want them to have to walk in half a mile to get into Sears. But yes, you guys can do whatever you want as a chief inspector as long as it's appropriate. Yeah, so that's fine. I just don't want to make it too hard for people that are hard to walk by moving it too far back, but I get that that is an issue. Okay, so yeah, it sounds like you guys can make something work, but I will touch base with Sears or the mall. We're going out Friday to pick up the keys and to figure out if there's a better way to get lights on earlier. We can talk about that. I know we have a different person that's in charge of all of our communications and stuff like that. I could touch base with him and see what their thing is, but that's usually out of my wheelhouse, but I can check on that. So we need to position the machine, in, like I said, to protect privacy. In certain locations, that's really easy because you're going to be up against a wall, but certain places like Sears, to be up against a wall, maybe 200 feet down the way. But just make it work. Plug in the machine, make sure it's turned on. Obviously, you want to be ready to go for the voter because usually we have little or no use of these machines, but I really want people to be, when they need the machine, have it be up and ready. So I'd encourage maybe even a few of you guys that vote at the same place you work to go ahead and use that just to make sure it works. I'd rather have you have issues with it than a voter have issues with it. So I would encourage you guys to vote early and use those machines. That way they're ready to go for when people that really need it are have it available for them. So before the polling place opens, you need to set up the DS200 just like you normally did. Plug in the machine, press the power button, and make sure the machine turns on. So usually about every other election, I get a call saying the machine's beeping, even though it's plugged in. So keep in mind there's a plugs into the wall, and then there's also a box that can get worked loose on the back of the machine that it needs to be plugged in. So if your machine's beeping, you need to work on that and let us know if you can't figure it out. But that means it's not plugged in. You're going to want to verify the seals number on the chain of custody form and the statement. Then you're going to want to check the ballot box and empty the slots to make sure everything is going through. We obviously just did that to make sure we didn't miss anything from February. But always, always look in there by the off chance we didn't miss up something, because I'd really rather have you know right away that there's something in there. I know one time we left our test ballots in there. We cleared our machine out, but we left our test ballot, and all of a sudden I got a call saying, oh my gosh, there's ballots in there. And it was our, thankfully they called right away, but it was our sample ballots that we used for testing. So I just came out and got those right away. But it does happen once in a while, so just make sure you look and see if it's empty. Last thing you gotta do is set up all your voting booths. I know this can be hard, kind of hard to set up at times, but make sure you set all those up. And sometimes they need two people to set up because their legs like to fall out and everything like that. And just try to set them up in the most lit area that you have there. Most of the lights still work, but a lot of them are starting to have issues because they're getting real old. You're going to want to set up the tables for tally slips, ballots, and poll list. Like I said, you're going to have a little bit more tables than what you guys are used to if this is an election you haven't worked in a while. Most polling places usually only had three or four. Some of them now, like Sears, will have seven or eight. So a little more big of a setup than what you're used to. Just make sure poll workers sign the poll list. So that what that means is when you're sitting in the table, if you go to work from 7 to 11 at that table, you're going to sign in at 7 saying you started with the tally slips, and then you know, at 11 you stopped. Why we really like to do that too is ultimately for chain of custody too, but if, you know, people make mistakes and it happens and we're not that worried when it comes to that, but every once in a while numbering will get wrong. And if the numbering got wrong at, let's just say, 1 in the afternoon, we can kind of go back to look to see, because maybe they can explain that numbering and maybe we can still fix the issue without it. So that's why it's kind of important to write the times that you worked on there. It's not a matter of trying to blame anybody or anything, but it just helps for training and stuff like that so we can get things right. So I would encourage you anytime, you know, the person may be signing that this went to the bathroom doesn't need to sign out and sign back in, but you may just want to say, you know, Tammy from 8:05 to 8:10. But yeah, just because, like I said, it's not a big deal, but like if there's a mistake made, it's really important to, you know, try to figure out. And it may just be like, oh, that makes mistakes make sense. Because what happens a lot of times is somebody will come in, and I see this once in a while, that somebody's like, I drove by the polling place, I saw that it was open, I came in and voted, I got a tally slip, I got the ballot, I don't have a clue who's on here. And so they'll actually give the ballot back, you know, because they're like, I don't even know who to vote for, because that's happened. And then all of a sudden they, we give take the ballot back, and then our machine's off by one. And that's something we can figure out. But I've had people do that, and then all of a sudden the numbering is wrong. So what we would have done in that case normally is just run the blank ballot through the machine if they truly don't want to vote. That way at least the numbers are right. But so stuff like that we can kind of figure out. And somebody might say, oh yeah, somebody gave me a ballot back. So it does happen. So, like I said, the person issuing the tally slip should record the beginning of the number that they issued and the ending of the issue, just so it makes it a little easier for us to check the automatic atomic clock for the official time. Keep in mind that's the official time, not the time on the machines. The machine should update automatically. We're not really able to make up the time because it is cellular, so it should update just like your cell phone does at home. But occasionally we have issues, and I think a lot of the issues has to do with the fact that they sit in our cave underneath the parking garage, underneath the ground, so it can't always get to that every time when it needs to, but it usually will update throughout the day. So we're trying to improve our poster system, so I don't know if you guys liked or didn't like what we did last time, but... Yeah, that's our intention. So we've actually improved it a little bit more going forward. I don't know how well this is going to work personally, but we're going to give it a shot. So you're going to get the exact same you got last time. So you're going to hold the two signs up that you got before. Just make sure you do both. I think last time I only seen some of you hang one. They're both different, so make sure you hang both of them. We're going to try our best to reuse those as much as we can. Obviously, after this election, redistricting should occur if the census can be completed and everything like that. So we're going to have different wards, potentially different polling places next time around in February. But we'd encourage you to try to keep those in the best shape you can. That way we're not printing those out every time. Like I said, I know for this one, they're going to be all thrown away because everything's going to be completely different in February. So we're going to do those. Plus, what we also did is for this time around is we are required to always post two copies of the ballots. I don't know exactly why two, but we are required to do two. So I actually scanned all the ballots, and you're going to get those done in posters too, just so they're clear. That's going to create a little bit more work because you're doing it anyways. I shouldn't say it's going to create more work. It's going to be less work, but it's going to be more space it takes up because it's a little bit bigger. Let me know how those go. If those don't work well, don't be afraid to say, don't do this again, and we'll just go back to the two sets of posters, and then you guys can hang up your ballots. It was really easy for this election because there's no back of the ballot, so we just did two fronts, but the next time around, we might have to do a front and a back for each ward. So both those posters are going to have everything you need. If you're hanging those posters plus the ballots, you do not need to hang anything else. And if you're hanging anything else, we probably got to have a conversation on why. It includes the map and everything like that you need. So it includes instructions for mail-in registered and first-time voters, general information on voting, contact information, voter qualifications poster, fraud poster, and overvoted ballot notice. So all those are included on those. And I guess I kind of jumped ahead. And it's still on the same poster. It's the notice of the general election, which I probably should just say notice of spring election, so I should have updated that. But you're gonna have the notice of the spring election, polling place hours and ward locations, and then the ward map. Keep in mind, like I said, we have two sample ballots per ward. It's one separate poster equals both the ballots. So if you're gonna make sure, like I said, you're gonna, for some of you guys, it's gonna be easy. Unfortunately for Sears, you're gonna have to hang up probably, 20 almost between the two polling places of that. But and what we're gonna struggle with is Sears is great. I don't think they're worried a little bit of tape, but if we're talking a polling place that's in a church or a nicer building, we'll be a little hesitant about taping everything on the wall. I think Blaine's has push pins that we could use in the future, and some of them have those. So we may have to come up with a solution on how to hang them so we don't ruin people's walls. And we already use painter's tape, but as a building owner, I might be a little apprehensive if you guys start coming in and taping a whole bunch of stuff. So. No, we use green frog tape, I think, and that's what they said works best and doesn't take the paint off. But so like I said, two sample ballots, posters are all gonna be included on one poster. So if you're like the library that has three polling places, you're gonna hang up the two main posters and then the three ones for each ward. So it'll be 13, 15, 29 over there. So you're gonna have five signs at the library and then you're done. And then like I said, unfortunately Sears is gonna have 2 plus 20 or whatever they have over there. So don't forget to include the how to mark a ballot in the voting booths. I think they're already in there most of the time, so you don't need to worry about it, but just make sure they're in there if they're not. Okay, voting at the polling place. Election inspectors initial the ballot and hand it to the voter. Election inspectors explain the ballot to their voter. Keep in mind, you're pretty limited on what you can say, but you're gonna wanna encourage them to, especially with this election, since there's a lot of people running for council, you may wanna hit with them that, you know, you can vote for four, or you can vote for three, depending on, you know, the school district, but encourage them, especially if you're starting to get people that are, you know, wasting ballots because they overvoted and then they got to come back and get a new one. I don't know how much an issue it's going to be, but encourage them to say, don't forget for these races, you can vote for one and vote for three. Up to three, I'd say up to three, because they don't have to vote for anybody if they don't want to, or just one. Election inspectors will also want to assist the voters if they're requested. It doesn't happen very often, but you as a poll worker can assist people, especially if they're unable to write or not, but you just have to sign the back of the ballot, I guess sign the front of the ballot in this case, to let them know you did help but fill out the ballot, but that is doable. There's privacy voters. Some people can be sensitive when it comes to who they voted for. So if somebody ever says, I don't want to walk from the poll booth to the voting machine with everyone being able to see my ballot, we do have folders that they can put them in if they feel more comfortable doing that. That is not an issue. Most of the time I see just people folders, and then that's good enough too. But privacy folders are available to you. Just keep in mind that all marked and unmarked ballots must be secured. Try your best to... if you, especially this election isn't a big deal, all your ballots are gonna fit in the machine that have been voted. But in previous elections, you know, we've had it where you've had to take them out because it's so busy throughout the day. So just make sure we can lock those up. You can put them in a, you know, way. So just make sure you're paying attention. That way nobody walks away with your ballots. So what happens when a voter makes a mistake on the ballot? It's not a big deal. If the voter makes a mistake on the ballot, they're gonna actually have to go back to the table that they got the ballots from. The voter has to sign the supplemental statement for an additional ballot. So if, you know, I made a mistake on my ballot, I'd have to go back to the table that I got my ward from, and then I would go and sign the supplemental sheet saying that, hey, I'm needing a new ballot. Not a big deal. It's gonna happen. Hopefully, if you start to see it happen, reiterate to your poll workers that they need to change their what they're talking about. Then you just have to issue the new ballot to the voter. Don't issue them a new tally slip, though. Only issue them the new ballot.
Do we have to write in the poll book also?
Are you talking about if just a normal voter... The inspector statement is sufficient. You don't have to do anything in the poll book. The only thing that I would encourage you to is if they were asking for a second ballot because there's an issue beyond what I would consider a typical, oops, I overvoted, or oops, I put a mark there and it doesn't like it, I would encourage you to put that in your inspector statement if there was an issue.
Okay.
that I need to know about. But more than likely, no, you don't have to do anything else. Just keep in mind the maximum number is 3 that they can receive. I don't think you're going to have a struggle and you get to 3, but if you ever give anybody a third ballot, strongly encourage them to use the express vote. The express vote will not allow for people to overvote. It will allow for people to obviously undervote, but it'll warn you at the end and say, hey, you can vote up to 3, you only voted for 2, is this okay? I would encourage that if it gets to that point, because they really can't screw that up. So if they get to 2 and you're giving them the third, put them on the express vote. It's not a forcing thing that we can do, but highly encourage it. Provisional voting, we kind of talked about that a little bit earlier. Here's the only 3 situations that people can use for provisional voting. Voters registered by mail and is marked POR required, and the voter does not have any proof of residency. There's none of them in the city of Janesville, and I'm hoping the next time we do this training I can just eliminate that option, but I just have left it in here by the off chance that it does come up again. Voter at the election day is registering and is unable or unwilling to provide the driver's license. So if you get somebody that recently moved here, well, let's check that, recently moved as of 29 days ago, they can register and vote, but maybe they don't have an ID yet that is valid in Wisconsin. They can still register and they can still vote, but it'd be provisionally. So, good question. I'll have to get back to you on that. I've always played the benefit of the doubt and included election day. But I think it's 29 days before, so I'll get back to you and I can put the date and correct in the thing in the briefcases. No one's ever actually asked me that question before ever, so I'm not prepared to answer. I think if you read the rules, and I'm probably wrong, I think it's 29 days before the election, so you probably wouldn't be able to count that. So I will change what I said earlier and say 28 days before the election. So just a rough guess, I think it'd be what, March 8th or 9th, maybe. All right, so the last one was it just if they are unable to show you their ID, you can vote provisionally. Okay, there you go. March 9th will be the correct date for whether or not they've lived at their location long enough to vote at the current polling place they're trying to stay at. So chief inspectors will handle the provisional voting process. Chief inspectors are a little familiar with this process, but thankfully it doesn't happen very often. I did just got done talking to Lisa, the county clerk, and different states have different rules, and other states that they don't have same-day voter registration, sometimes they are still allowed to vote, but they're voted provisionally. I think she said Ohio had 18,000 provisional ballots issued during an election, and that's actually crazy, and I'm so glad we do it the way we do it, because I would be surprised if even the long-term chief inspectors have ever had to do 18 provisional ballots throughout their career. And I would say 99% of those happen on presidential elections. So I don't foresee it being a real issue, but just keep in mind it does happen. Chief inspectors have a checklist that they follow. It's pretty straightforward. But like I said, go home, get that ID if there's time. It makes your life and my life and the voter's life a lot easier. Okay, so you survived the day, and hopefully with no major issues. Like I said, if you have a character, somebody that likes to ham it up a little bit, feel free to send them out there and say, hear ye, the polls are now closed at 8 o'clock. Right? The polls have to close at 8 o'clock sharp. That does not mean, though, that if the voter's in line that they can't vote. So anybody that's in line at 8 o'clock gets to vote. So make sure you guys use a monitor if there is a line. I don't think you'll have a line, and if you do have a line at 8 o'clock on this Tuesday, I'm going to be questioning what I did, probably to get you guys set up, because I did something wrong. So if there happens to be a line, make sure somebody stands at the end of the line to make sure everybody gets to vote at 8 o'clock, gets to vote, and if anybody came in late, I'm sorry, they can't vote. Make sure all absentee ballots have been processed. We probably changed that a little bit to say make sure all absentee ballots have been called. I don't care if you get it at 8 o'clock, you need to call us or 7:59 and 59 seconds, you need to call us. Don't bring it into City Hall and tell us you have it. You need to call us because we'll go get it. Because we keep the absentee boards. That's why we call you at 8 o'clock for the numbers. We really could care less about the numbers at 8 o'clock at this point because we already know roughly where we're going to be at. We're mainly concerned of, do you have any ballots that I need to pick up? Because we keep the absentee ballots, like I said, the board open until at least 8 o'clock. And if once we get the word that everybody has none, we shut it down. So, and if you guys would happen to bring one in, and I know it's happened once, we would have to, we could still, their vote would count and it would work. We just would have to manually update everything, so. All right, so the machine is programmable to print the necessary numbers of the tapes, and then you gotta sign the paper. I do believe since we have a county, a state race, a city race, a school district race, I do believe we're going to have four because of Milton and Janesville. So you're going to have four tapes, unfortunately. Most of them, I only need three, but just give me all four because every once in a while they'll have a snafu and I'll be making copiers, and it's really annoying to have those long sheets of paper with me at a copy machine. So just give me all four. Most of them are going to be, only need three, but it'll print four. I have no control over that, but the question was, is do we keep the larger font on the tape? I don't see any reason why Lisa would have changed that back. She actively chose to make it bigger the last time around. It wasn't a mistake, and it just happened to work out. I think as a request, I don't see why she would have went back to the smaller tape. But I agree, it was a lot easier. And I do believe, now that I think about it, when we were doing the testing, I think I remember seeing the bigger fonts. But I didn't test those machines, somebody else did. So, if you happen to have any observers and they're interested in knowing the results, just read them out loud. And I don't think you're going to have any observers that we're going to want the results, mainly because we sometimes see it in like Rock County Board Supervisors because it's a little more ward specific. No real observers are going to come and say, unless they have one at every polling place to try to figure out who won council. But so you shouldn't see any observers there at the end of the night. All right, you're going to place all those tapes that you guys signed in the blue security bag. You're going to turn off the express vote, remove the thumb drive, replace the thumb drive, and put it in the blue security bag. I think after this election, I found one thumb drive and one express vote, and I won't call out who did that, but if you could just remember who to do that at the end of the day, it's not a real big deal. Just usually when I'm really tired after election day, and I know you guys are there, I'm climbing over machines and everything to try to dig that out of there. So. Close the DS-200, that's the voting machine, and then you follow the separate instructions provided in the chief inspector's. You also want to place the thumb drive in there, so at the end of the day, you should have two thumb drives. If you don't have two thumb drives, then we have a little bit of an issue, which isn't a big deal. Like I said, I can catch it on the next day, hopefully, before they pack all those machines away. So closing the polling place. You got to review the ballots for registered write-ins. As of right now, always subject to change until 4 o'clock, I think, on election day or 5, or sorry, 4 or 5 on the Friday before the election is we have no write-ins as of now. Hopefully it stays that way because it makes my life and your life a lot easier. If we do have any write-ins, you got to record the write-ins on both return sheets, and then you just got to complete the both return sheets. You guys are doing a real good job at that. As chief inspectors, I've not really seen any major issues. I know this time around in February and in this one, I combined them, so, you know, Sears is going to have one for one side and one for another side. The Jobs Center is going to also have one. I don't need three from separate ones from Sears. Actually, be five separate ones from Sears and three separate ones from the Jobs Center. So at the end of the night, I'm only going to have six. That's five polling places plus then the absentee board. The question was, if there wasn't an official write-in, do you have to count that? As of right now, no. They have like a unique rule that if more than two people are running for a seat, and if more than three people are running for two seats, you never have to count write-ins unless there's a registered write-in. So you don't have to count anything as at the end of the day. The only thing you want to keep in mind is, and some voters struggle, if say they wanted to vote for Joe that's running for city council. And Joe's name's on the ballot, but they will write in Joe's name. We need to make sure we at least glance at those to make sure that didn't happen, because then technically we would count that vote, as long as we could tell voter intent. So sometimes, I don't know why it happens, but the name will be on the ballot, but they'll write in that same person. So in that case, then you would have to count it. But It doesn't happen very often, but I do see it occasionally. Yes, so the question is, what kind of is a registered write-in? Yes, they would either work with the state or the county, depending on the race, and they would come up to them and say, I want to be on the ballot. They got to fill out the correct paperwork. We get notification. So Lisa, which is a county clerk, will come to me on Friday night after right before she leaves and says, hey, these are the write-ins or these aren't the write-ins. So those are the ones we have to count. So let's just say you could still run a race, in theory, if nobody was running as a non-registered write-in and win, and we would have to count yours, but usually there doesn't happen very often where there's not a need for a registered write-in because there's always people usually running for a race, and then that usually triggers you. We don't have to count those unofficial write-in votes. No, we do not have to count Donald Duck, but like I said, most of the time you have to be a registered write-in before they count. There are some very unique situations, which thankfully we don't have very often because that just means nobody was running. Then we'd have to count everybody that wrote in. I don't believe for a registered write-in after the fact has to get signatures, but that's something I've never dealt with. I do believe they just got to go to the proper place, whether it's the county, state, or local, and fill out paperwork. But keep in mind, it's going to be really hard to win without actually being on the ballot and do that. So, but you do see that, like I said, when nobody decides to run, and then all of a sudden they're like, whoops, then oh, I might as well try to run then. All right, so at the end of the night, like I said, just complete all the returnship. You guys, return sheets. You guys have been doing a really good job at that. So explain any discrepancies in voter counts. Try the best to explain those. Sometimes you can't, sometimes you can, but feel free to explain those to the best of your ability. And then just don't forget to complete all your registration forms in the suitcase. So at the end of the day, before you guys, when you hand off your suitcase to us, we'll look through and see what we have, but just try to make sure the registrations are in there. Miscellaneous, just make sure you guys sign everything. There should at least be an odd number of signatures. Sometimes there's a spot for more than three, at least three at the minimum. But I don't want four, I'll take five. I don't want six, I'll take seven or five, just as long as it's an odd. Seal the ballot at the end of the night. You're gonna wanna lock the ballots into the bags into the ballot bin. And you know, I totally missed updating this slide, so I'm gonna apologize. We're gonna do something slightly different for this election. We're gonna pick the ballots up at the end of the night. So we have a couple different possibilities that we're working through, and it's gonna be more the role of the chief inspectors to help me out with this is, you know, I don't want you guys there any later than you have to. It's already a long enough day for you guys. We're gonna have people that are gonna go and pick up the ballots. Well, if we start at, let's just say hypothetically, the job center, Sears is gonna be last on your list. So either you're gonna have to wait at Sears until we can pick up the ballots, or if you give me a call and say, hey, we're done, I'm not waiting, I'm gonna take the ballots with me, we can go that road too. Because I really don't want you guys waiting here any longer than you have to, but we're gonna actually have people coming to get those ballots at the end of the night. And so at the end of the day, all the chief inspectors are gonna return the results to City Hall, and like I said, we're gonna try our best to be there out, you know, but no later than 8:45, which I think should be able to get all you guys before you're done, but we'll pick up your ballots. Just make sure everybody should leave together after all the tasks have been completed. Like I said, the exception to that is as we're trying to work through this process of picking up ballots, you know, you may want to just, maybe three of you will stick on by and wait until we come, or like I said, you grow tired of us, but like I said, we're hoping to get it pretty well by 8:45, 9 o'clock. We're going to have two people doing it. Yeah, that's why we're changing the process. Before, we used to just lock them up and leave them in the polling place, and we'd have our workers pick them up the next day. The poll workers, otherwise what we're going to do is if we're going to try to pick them up, and with city staff, we're going to mark them down, you're going to say, hey, Tammy gave us five bags. Here are the serial numbers. And then what we would do is at the end of the day say, okay, shall we? One of the city staff is going to be like, okay, I received these five. And then when they come back to us, we're going to be like, okay, we have those five. So if there was anything going on, we're going to know because she's going to give us serial numbers. The person's going to have serial numbers in there. And then I'm going to check the serial numbers when they come back. So there's going to be a chain of command so we know. As long as they'll fit and as long as you have wards, like, for you guys, it'd be 11, 14, 16, 17, 18. As long as you're stacked together like that, that's fine. I don't want you to have just take them out of the machine and say, here you go. So yeah, as long as they're sorted in the bags, then I'm good with that. Like I said, just make sure everybody can leave together. So please arrive by 6 a.m. Park as far away from the door as you're comfortable walking, but we encourage you to park as far away as you can. No electioneering within 100 feet of the polling places. I don't think we had an issue with that in February. Obviously, we had an issue with that in November, but we didn't have any major issues. If you have any questions throughout the day or prior to the election, feel free to call me at 755-3073. Just don't call me on my direct line or my cell phone because usually I'm not available. So other than that, I think we're doing okay as far as that goes. We have a little bit more workers than we had before. Like I said, I don't really know what Tuesday is going to bring because we thought at City Hall, I was planning on, you know, 40, 50 people voting a day. We're lucky if we have gotten 25 to the highest. So it's a little, I think, unique. But I don't know if that's because everybody's voted early or is it because everybody's going to feeling a little bit more comfortable and is going to the polling place. But like I said, Tuesday will help us figure that out. The question was, is, you know, based on the staffing, is it all right if to continue with the combining of tables? Yes. You guys do whatever you feel is necessary to make it work. You guys are the bosses, not me. If there's something wrong, I'll point it out, but I'm not going to care how you do it as long as everybody votes. That's legally able to vote, and as long as you guys are handling it in a most efficient manner. So, yep, professional and manner, yeah. Question was, what about food? Yes, we're bringing in food again. Lunch and dinner. Hopefully the volume was okay. I know we had one issue at one of the polling places. I really don't like to waste food personally. In November, we wasted a lot of it. So we really cut back in February. Did we have any issues besides the one that people didn't have enough food? Otherwise, we're going to order almost the same levels that we did before. Okay. Yep. We'll try our best. It's a struggle because, like I said, I could order 5 or 6 extra per food, but I just I would encourage anybody that has a specific diet to maybe bring their own or have that. But otherwise, it's going to be the same as before. We're not going to get any more unique. It's probably going to be Jimmy John's for lunch, and I don't remember if it's Domino's for dinner, but we'll help you with that again. We will work on getting plates. If I just have to buy them at work, I will buy them and bring them. I don't know why. I'm really actually a little disappointed that they didn't provide them because I know a lot of places did, and that's why we didn't even think about it. But yeah, I felt kind of stupid when you guys didn't have plates, but I feel bad. Yep. Okay, Jerry. Yep, trash can. It's. Yep. Yep, if you remember to email me, that'd be great because I'll try to remember when I get home or when I get back to work, but that's a big challenge nowadays to remember an hour from now. Question? If you're on your lunch break, you can do what you want, as long as you're back whenever you're supposed to do. Yep, and I know a few people have said to me that, like, I got a dental appointment or I got this going on. Just let your chief inspectors know right away. They'll try to work with you to the best of your ability. And you know, I don't know if your dog's on specific times and you're like, hey, I'd really be nice if I'd go at 11. Usually they'll work with you. But just let them know right away. But because I know a few people have appointments and they're like, well, do you not want me to work? I'm like, no, we'll take you. I mean, it's what, a 13-hour day, 14-hour day. If you need to take an hour off to go to the doctor or the dentist, go ahead. You know, we'll make it work. I'd rather have you for 12 or 13 hours than none. Andrea? Okay, so what the express machine was, the question was, what is it all about? So basically, the express vote is a requirement that the state needs us to have for, it's for designed for handicapped and hard of hearing and disabled people to vote. You put a slip of paper that's about yay size in there. There's nothing on the ballot. When you put the machine, put it in the machine, the actual race comes up. So the first race will be state superintendent, well, for one. And let me take a step back. Due to the fact that Beloit has a large Hispanic population, she started putting stuff in Spanish because it's getting close to where she legally has to. So at first, you're going to be able to do is select your language, English and Spanish. So once you do that, the poll worker has to select the words. Where are you working at? Okay, so you downstairs, you only have 3 and 4. So what you would do as a poll worker, you'd take the ballot over there, put it in the machine, and it's gonna only give you the option to select either 3 or 4. You're gonna have to select that for the voter because, nope, it's a push button, like a computer that's push. You can use the screen. Touch screen. So yeah, you're gonna go over there and say, pick their ward for them, and then you walk away. Unless they have any questions. So then the first thing that's going to show up is it's going to say, hey, you know, who do you want to vote for state superintendent? And then they pick the person. And then it goes to the Rock County District 5, whatever judge it is. And then it's going to allow you to pick that person. It also gives you the option to then not vote for somebody, because if you don't want to vote in that race, you can vote no. And then it also allows you to do write-in. So say there were a registered write-in you wanted to vote for. You click on write-in, it brings up a whole keyboard, and it allows you to type the name in there. So that's the first part. And then at the end of the day, when they're all selected, it gives you an overview of who you voted for. It allows you then to figure out if you made a mistake, you can go back. If you feel like it's good, you hit next. In the ballot, you can actually hear printing in there. So, and then all of a sudden the ballot comes back out. The ballot looks nothing like you're used to. It does print the names on there. So if you ever still want to do a double check, you're going to get their ballot and it's going to say, you know, I voted for Joe, Bill, Ann, you know, Mark and whatever. So you can say, okay. So the ballot's only about yay big. And it doesn't, like I said, look anything like it. You can actually put those in the machine and then the machine will count those. This last year we modified the machines. So the one on the bottom takes the full ballots and then the one on top takes the little smaller ballots. And so they put those through the machines. Just because it's a handicapped and a disabled machine, every voter has the right to use those machines. So if anybody says, I want to use that machines, just say, okay, let me go get you a ballot. Question?
Use and
abuse your chief inspector for questions like that. Yep, exactly. If you have a lot of questions, reach out to your chief inspectors. I don't think any of your chief inspectors are here right now to ask questions for Andrea, but they've definitely been doing it since I've been here, so they've been doing it a while. So, any more questions? Yep, Jerry? I guess, so the question was, if you're turning in an absentee ballot for someone, is that appropriate? Whether it's your neighbor you're dropping it off for, or, you know, you're dropping it off for, you know, your husband or your wife. The answer to that question is tricky. It's yes and no. Yes, it's appropriate for anybody to drop off a ballot if that's what you feel is done, but is everything done on the envelope? Is a signature on there? The address for the signature for the witness? If it's done, it's done, then you're fine. But keep in mind, if the missing information and you can't take it, I mean, you can take it, but it's not gonna count. So I would encourage, you know, if you're gonna do it, that's fine, but just reiterate to them, like, you know, if there's missing information, I'm gonna try my best to tell you, but we really need, you know, if you missed a signature and you're not here in front of me, I can't take the ballot. I mean, you can take it, like I said, it's just not gonna count, so. But yeah, it's perfectly appropriate for, you know, that happened a lot at City Hall when neighbors and, you know, parents or kids drop off ballots for people, so. Yep. Question? Yep, go ahead and ask away. We got a couple minutes. And if you wanted to, I don't have my next training until 10:30, so I can sit with you and ask your questions. Otherwise, I got 2 minutes. So yeah, I do apologize. Usually November is a little bit more of a unique situation. November is pretty much all hands on deck, unfortunately. And so sometimes things do slip through the cracks that I feel like probably shouldn't. In a perfect world, we would never have you start in November. We would have you start in February, April, and work your way up to November. Not that this, what we do is by no means complicated, but it is, we do have to follow the rules. So usually as a chief inspector, they try to put you with somebody that's a more seasoned chief or more worker. The problem we ran into with it in November is a lot of our seasoned workers were unable to work because of COVID and other various reasons. So I do apologize. And yes, and another unique thing about what you just talked about, which was a supplemental poll book list, that is at the back of the book, because what we used to do is registration ends at 5 o'clock on Friday before the election. So we don't print poll books until Friday night, Saturday morning. What used to make it really nice is prior to when WISVO came online, which was a couple years ago, anybody that registered before 5 o'clock would automatically get put in the correct order. Now what they have is called late registration. Right now we're in, I think, late registration mode. You come in and register for me with today, you're late. Still eligible, but late. So you're in the back of the book. Prior to that, they never did that. So you'd always just be put in order. So that's a little more unique thing that's only happened over the last few years. So some of the seasoned poll workers are gonna say, well, we never had that before either, and that's why. So that is something that sometimes slips through the cracks because we never had to deal with that before. So I do apologize, and work with your chief inspectors. Maybe I'll come up with like funny hats or something that they can wear. I'm sure you guys would be thrilled about that. Maybe you guys can come up with your own ideas. But yeah, that does make sense on busy elections to have them somehow identifiable more than just the badges that they have. And you know, maybe we can talk to the chief inspectors and see what works for them. I don't really want to do anything that would embarrass them or embarrass me. So we'll go ahead and talk there. But we'll have some conversation afterwards. I want to try to honor your time. I think it's been here an hour, and I really don't like to talk. So if anybody that knows me knows I'm done. My parents are back here, so they know I'm done. So unless anybody has any questions, we'll see you. Damn. Suitcases are at 11:30 on Saturday. You will not see me again. You'll see Liz. Be patient. She's still trying to learn you guys' names. And I know there's a few unique situations with chief inspectors this time around. So I know we only have two at the job center and two at the library and one at the library that's not normally there. So just to be patient with Liz and make sure you guys take the right ones, because I know there was a little bit of an issue last time. Not that we didn't take the wrong ones, but somebody took more than what they should have. No, Jerry has requested that Tom do those. So I already called her, and she will not be picking up the poll books. And so Jerry will work with Tom to make sure that the poll books get picked up. So you just worry about what you normally would. Okay. All right? All right, everybody have a good day. Stay safe. Enjoy your Easter. All right, guys. Hello, how are you today? For those of you that did not work the last election, you may wonder why you see me versus Dave. Dave is the former clerk, currently interim finance director for the city of Janesville, so that made me the interim clerk treasurer. So I'm Derek, for those that don't know me. So you'll see me this time around instead of Dave, which you normally have seen. So April central count training is what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk a little bit about the current election and some counts that we have going on and how to set up central count, and a little bit of review on how February went, and then just a little bit about the procedures. So I did add a few more things in, so hopefully you get a little bit more out of this meeting than you did last time. So for this current election, just to make everybody aware, there's about five races on there. You're going to see the state superintendent of public instruction, which is going to be vote for one. The Rock County Circuit Court Judge Branch 5, which is also vote for one. Janesville City Council, vote for four. And Janesville School District, vote for three. And you're either going to see Janesville or the Milton School District vote for four. You won't see both. You're going to see one or the other. I think there's about six wards that are in Milton. And then Rock County Affordable Care Act referendum. This is a non-binding referendum, but it is still a referendum that's on the ballot. So basically, for all the new people, non-binding referendum means that even if it's totally approved or totally denied, it really doesn't matter, because it's just encouraging the state to do it. It's not forcing the state to do it. So as of 3/30/21, we've issued about 4,900 ballots. That is a little bit higher than what we're obviously used to because of COVID going on. We've received only about 2,100 back as of 2 days ago. This is kind of probably follow the same pace that we did last time. Last time we had a very low number, and then the last 3 or 4 days, we got a lot, which I guess I shouldn't be surprised, because in life, I think generally everybody waits at the last minute to do everything. So I would assume probably by election day that 2,100 may creep up into the 3,000 range. I'm not quite sure. Absentee voting at City Hall has been very surprisingly slow. I expected 50 to 40 maybe a day, because I was planning for the worst, because we have a lot of new staff in our office, and I was trying to come up with plans that would work really well for them, and I was coming up with plans, and then it's knocking wood all for naught, because I haven't had to do any of those. It's been surprisingly slow. I think we're only averaging maybe 25 at the most, as low as 8 or 9 one day. I don't know if that's a testament to everybody getting an absentee ballot already in the mail, or people are starting to get more comfortable in actually going to the polling place. But I guess we really won't figure that out until Tuesday. So absentee ballots are going to be processed here at City Hall again. We're going to have the same space as we did before. City Hall is obviously under construction and through the front, and they were nice enough to hold off on the changes that they need to make so you guys could be at City Hall. City Hall would always be my preferred location for you guys, because I'm right there at City Hall, and if we ever have any questions, we can help you. So they were nice enough to wait until after the election to start that work again on the front. Because once that work happens, there's going to be offices in that room that you guys are normally in. I think City Hall is going to be back together. There was some flood damage up there, so I think they put that together earlier this week. So it'll be all nice and new looking for you guys up there. Good question, Diane. I don't know if the heat will be on or not. I can touch base with them. I do believe if you look at the forecast, it's supposed to be like 70. So hopefully there's not too much heat being used, because last time was very cold for places like Sears and City Hall, and I know you guys were cold probably up there, but you guys didn't realize how good you had it. Unfortunately for the people that worked at Sears and even at City Hall, it was cold. We had our heaters that we have for the surge shelter in use, but it still couldn't keep up, so I'm hoping it's 70 and you guys don't have to worry about it too much, but I will ask that question. So I don't know if we have any new workers, but if we have any new workers, just make sure you stop at City Hall. You guys have it really nice, because you'll be at City Hall on Election Day, and you'll have time to fill out any paperwork you need. Basically, the paperwork you're going to need is as if you're a new employee at any company. Social Security card, driver's license, stuff like that. Most of you guys look pretty familiar to me, so I don't think I have any new ones here, but I may be wrong. So February issues. I just want to thank you guys for the work that you guys did in February, because there's no major issues in February. It's kudos and compliments to you guys. With this new DS450, we're trying to figure this out together. If you guys do a good amount of prep work, this machine can really fly. In November, I sometimes feel like we'd still be working on that election if we didn't have that high-speed counter. It's amazing. Once AJ gets it dialed in, AJ's a big, tall guy. You've seen him all before. He runs it. He has a good assistant with Teresa and stuff like that. Man, when they can get things going, they can make it fly. It really surprising. The processing time, we were astronomically faster than what I thought you guys were going to be. Normally, 1,500 ballots, I expected you guys to be work on that for 5, 6, 7 hours to get that done. I think you were done after like three hours. I mean, that's just a testament to you guys. It's crazy. I wish we could have had this machine a lot longer ago, but we're very fortunate to have it now. Thankfully, the county stepped up and paid for that for us. If you guys weren't aware, that's county property. They bought it for us, so I really appreciate that. So if you ever see Lisa, the county clerk, make sure you thank her. She really went out of her way to get that for us. Just overall with the DS-450, we just had some minor issues, but as every election goes on, we're starting to nail that down even further. I just encourage you guys, when you're opening the ballots, to spend that time and make sure you unfold it to the best of your ability and straighten it out. It was really never an issue with the old machines that we straightened it out and unfolded it to the best of our ability, but if you guys spend the work in doing it before it gets to us, it's a lifesaver. Like I said, we can make this machine fly. If everything's ready to go. AJ works with Teresa to get that going, but if anything can be done prior to that, feel free to straighten them and get them in the order before you send them over our way to the other room. One thing I did learn is that I call it the processing team, for lack of better words. They were sitting around a lot before they received the first ballot, so I feel bad for you guys that had to sit around in that room for like an hour. So I think I'm going to make some changes, and some of you guys are going to be coming in at, I think, one or new. I can't remember the exact time. We're going to touch base with you guys later on. Some of you guys are going to be coming in an hour later. That's not anything against what you did or didn't do, but I just don't want you sitting around for an hour waiting for those ballots. AJ's going to come in to make sure the machine starts right away because that's a priority. Other than that, we're going to have a group of people that comes in right away. That gets the ballots moving along, and then the other group will come in an hour later, kind of, that way not everybody's coming in all at once and sitting around. So, everybody seems to want to work here, which is a good thing, because we need a good group of core volunteers that always want to come here, because it makes Diane's job and my job a lot easier. But with this particular election, we have, I think, 43 people assigned to this polling place. That's really not feasible to have 43 people. I'm not going to really make any changes right now, because I fear that if a second, third, or fourth wave or whatever we're on was all of a sudden going to happen to us, I don't want you guys to get decimated. But if it comes on election day, or you want to tell me now that you're not afraid to be moved to a polling place, please let me know, because we may need to shift you, because we just don't need 43 people there today. But I'm hesitant to make changes. What? No. So I'm hesitant to make any changes yet until we need to. Otherwise, it may be like last time where some of you guys come in and only help for 2 or 3 hours. But if you guys say, hey, I don't really mind working in a polling place, let me know. So we'll be more than happy to move you this time around, assuming we have no major absences all of a sudden. But obviously, on a polling place day, everything is important, and you guys are no more important than the people that are working the polling places. But I got to make sure I have staff for you guys, because they end at 8. You guys are end when you're done. There's a big difference. So I want to make sure you guys are done at 8 and stick around until 8:30 or whatever until we hear from the chief inspectors. I don't ever want you guys in the future ever working past 8, with the exception of those last few ballots. So it's a priority of mine to make sure you guys have enough people, but I feel like you're going to have too much right now. So the first thing you guys are going to do when you get in is you're going to set up the DS-450 for processing the ballots. I haven't decided on the express votes, and I was going to talk to you guys about it. Do you guys like making the votes with the express votes to remake the ballots? Okay, we can make it work. We'll make the machines, we'll have the express votes in there to remake the ballots. I have the paperwork and everything ready to go, and we've done the testing and everything like that, so we can go either way. You know, when I think of express votes and how to remake ballots, it really comes down to a couple different things. I think making express votes in... remaking the ballots and express votes is really easier and simpler in that machine. And faster. The downside to using that machine is, you know, some people may be overwhelmed and stuff like that. We don't have our usual people that remake ballots. I know I had a few volunteers already willing to help learn, but that's something, remaking ballots is something, you know, that has to be very diligent and very cognizant of what they're doing, because you're remaking somebody's ballot. And so it's really important that we just don't let anybody do that. Not that any of you guys do a bad job, but it's just really important that we pick the right person to do that. Just like in previous elections, we're gonna have multiple tables set up for processing ballots, similar to like we had before. So we're gonna set up and you guys are gonna work in groups just like you have in the past to open ballots and stuff like that. Question? So there's multiple different reasons a ballot has to be remade. One could be as simple as, yes, you're damaged. We've tried to not damage ballots, and we've gotten a lot better of it, but one of the first times we started using the absentee ballots, we were using the wrong opener. It was ripping like 20% of the ballots. We were remaking a ton. So we've gotten to the point now where we're pretty good about not remaking very many ballots, but besides damage, you also could, say you particularly, what's a good example of, you spilt coffee on your ballot. We get those all the time, you know, and that doesn't read in the machine. Say your ballot, you were just dragging your pen a little bit and it marked in a different area. Those, when the machines are reading, they're only set to read certain areas. And if they see a mark that's sometimes outside of their area, it doesn't like it. And that's another reason why we need to remake. And then a couple, was it November, that we had to remake a lot of ballots because of the where it got folded. So some of the machines, when the ballot got folded, it kind of left a different mark, or the mark was harder to read because it happened right on a fold. And it must have been a candidate that either was running unopposed or a popular candidate, because we were running, remaking a lot of ballots. So Lisa, the county clerk, has tried in her best to not have something on the fold. But unfortunately for this election, there'll be another one where there's no fold that's going to affect us. So no, it has to be two people. Just to, you know, peace of mind, not saying that anybody would do that here because I trust all you, but by the off chance, you know, when you're reading the news and you want to see about all the, you know, potential election fraud that has happened, that would be an area, if we only had one person doing it, that really could be easily done. So there will be two people that does it, because what they'll sit there and do is say, you know, here's your ballot here that has to be remade. It'll sit in front. Somebody will mark it. At the end of the express vote, there's always an overview. It says who you voted for. Both of them will look at that again and say, okay, you know, vote for candidate one, vote for candidate two, vote for candidates one, three, and five. And, oh, yep, we agree. And then they'll hit print, and then they'll go ahead and give it to AJ to run it through. So there will be a double check just to be sure that nobody is, you know, incorrectly making the ballot. Diane? So yeah, there's other reasons why a ballot would also have to be remade. Like she was saying that, you know, sometimes people overvote and stuff like that. So in order to get the ballot to count, we have to do it that way to remake a ballot. Or sometimes we've had it where, you know, there's so much non-voter intent where we just have no clue what they were doing. And then we'll actually have to send a blank ballot through just so the count's right. But, all right. So we'll set up the express votes. Diane, are you thinking you'd like one or two express votes?
I think one.
That's what I was thinking too, but I would go with you. So we'll have one express vote up and running for you guys upstairs. You'll have to just remake your ballots there. And it sounds like you had a couple of volunteers that we'll work with that they need to at least do it in groups of two to remake it. So central count. So we're gonna deliver all the ballots in alphabetical order like we've done in the past. You're also gonna get a paper log for all those ballots. So the first thing you got to do is count the number of ballots inside. And thankfully, it's not like November. We're seeing a couple hundred probably per ward. You need to first count all of the ballots that are in the box and compare it to the number of ballots that are returned. So what you're going to do is you're going to get a box from us, and it may have 100 in there. That log at the end of it, if you look back, will say 100 returned. We're able to, fortunately, since it isn't November, we're able to run these on Tuesday. So we're going to have pretty, pretty accurate numbers. So if you have 77 ones that were returned for Ward 1, you're going to be able to look at the sheet, and at the last sheet it's going to say 77, and then when you count them, it should be 77 too. If there is an issue, let me know and let our office know. It could just be as simple as what will sometimes happen is we'll miss scanning it. So Diane returned her ballot to us. We just didn't scan it because we got stuck together with another one at the time, or, you know, the computer glitched out at that second and we didn't notice it. But so always call to let us know if the numbers don't match. I think Diane can speak better on this. Did we have any issues with that in the past?
Not really.
Okay, not really. Yeah, in a perfect world, we'd have all the ballots in by Tuesday, and then you would never have to worry about it. But what she said is pretty much the numbers have been that on from what we want in the morning. Sometimes we run into issues when ballots have been returned throughout the day. Sorry, I forgot I could take that off when I'm up here. You can probably hear me better. All right, so when you're doing the ballots, besides the counting when you move on, you're going to want to make sure you review the envelopes for signatures and addresses. So for those of you that are a little bit unfamiliar, there's two signatures required on every ballot for an envelope. There's going to be the voter signature and then the witness signature. And then the final thing you're going to check is witness's address. So you're going to have three things to check for. We've really tried to improve this over time, so there's three highlights. And all three of those highlights need to have information in there. You got to use a little bit of common sense. Even though the voters sometimes struggle to understand that they need to write in the highlighted lines, sometimes the signature will be above the line, below the line. As long as there's two signatures on there and there's an address on there, we're going to take that. I don't care. You sometimes read in the news or hear in the paper. I don't care if my middle name's Paul. I don't care if I just wrote Derek Heist, you're fine. I don't have to write Paul. I don't have to write P for middle initial. It's reasonable. Then I also get the question is, what happens if somebody just marked an X? That's fine, they're allowed to mark an X. You don't really judge the signature because that's not really our role. They just gotta make sure there's a signature. And there's some people that struggle to write it. So as long as there's a signature on that line and a signature on the witness line and then the address on the witness line too. It has to be have all three. If you don't have all three and we missed it and you need to not count that one, we'll try to work with the voter to have them come down to fix it. But with being on election day, sometimes it happens, sometimes it doesn't, but we try our best. Now, just to let you all know, if we get one in City Hall and we notice it, we either send it back to the voter or call them. So if you got it, you got it by mistake, or you're getting the stuff at the end of the day that say, we weren't able to resolve these, you need to reject these. Because we do approving, and I think we do a pretty good job, but we are bound to miss one or two. But so if you get one that's missing one of those three things, signature and address, you need to talk to Diane right away and probably not count it. There might be a reason why we can, but let Diane and the other chief inspectors help with that in determining that. That's fine, as long as, once again, you need, yep, you need three signatures, and what happens if they vote in person? When we vote in person at City Hall staff is the witness, so you're still gonna have my signature and any other my seven staff members' signature, and then they're gonna also use City Hall's address, and we have them all stamped, pre-stamped, you're gonna see a lot of them, but just make sure all three of those are on there missing. Technically, if the voter didn't sign and they came from City Hall, you can't count that. So we'll try our best to reach out to the voter to make sure they can come down and sign it, but if they missed it, and then we missed it, so, like I said, envelopes that have address and signature should be opened and the ballot removed. And then the next step on that is the voter number will be assigned and entered into the log and envelope by my staff. So basically what that's trying to say is, assuming you have both signatures and the address, you're going to open the ballot. Once that ballot comes out, your first ballot for that you do for the ward is going to be ward one, or sorry, number one. The next one's going to be number two, and so on, and so on, and so on. You need to put that number on the ballot. So if you have Ward 1, ballot 50, it's going to have Ward 1, ballot 50 on there. You're also going to write that coinciding on that paperwork, too. So at the end of the thing, when you're opening them all up, in reality, your sheet should have, let's just say, 72, and then your ballots, that your last one you write on is also 72. That way you can easily figure it out. Make sure you keep them in alphabetical order, rubber banded. I don't know if that's necessary for this election. Presidential election is super important. I think the big thing about that is I don't necessarily need to be rubber banded, but you need to separate by ward. Don't, if you're done with your ward, don't start another ward and put your ballots in the same thing. Although there's nothing really wrong with it, the new machine is awesome. It doesn't like it when you try to read multiple wards at one time. The machine has the ability to read. We could shove every ballot on there and you'd be able to read it. It really works better when we say, let's send all the Ward 1s through, send all the Ward 2s through, and then send all the Ward 3 throughs. We can always go back and do more at the end, but it does not like it when we put a stack of Ward 1, 2, and 3 on there. So I don't necessarily know if rubber banding is necessary, but please make sure when you're done, if AJ is behind or they haven't come to grab them yet, just be like, set them aside and say, these still need to be done, but I need a new box for mine so I can move on to the next ward. Ballots are then processed through the DS-450. Like I said, that's AJ that mainly does that, and Teresa that's been helping out a lot. But like I said, when you're placing them in that tub, try to spend an extra few minutes and try to help straighten it. You'd be shocked with how much easier it makes our life work for it. So after you process all the ballots for the ward, you should write the last number of the tally slip. So what that means is, even though there's no tally slip per se, if you're the last one number you wrote was 72, you need to write 72 on the top and then circle it. Why that is important is, like Diane was saying, we get ballots throughout the day. We legally have to count everything we receive by 8 o'clock, or everything we receive by 8 o'clock we have to count on election day. So people will bring them in at 3 or 4, and even 7:50 or 7:59 I've seen at the polling places. And we also go out and check our box at 8 o'clock too, so that's where we get a lot of them from. So you need to go back then and redo those wards that you've already done. So you don't want to look through that book to find out, like, what ward number I'm on. You want to go through there and just say, well, I did 72, so the next one I got to do is 73. I do think one problem, though, that we ran into that we see once in a while is, that's great that you wrote 72 on there, and then you wrote 75 on there when you finished. Cross the 72 out as soon as you move on, because that way there's no confusion. I'd rather have you cross out 72 and forget to write 75 than forget to cross out 72 and all of a sudden the numbers are wrong. So I'd encourage you, as soon as you grab that book and you know you need to use it, probably just to cross those numbers out right away. Make them so we can still see them, but cross them out right away. I'd rather have you, you know, the next set of group that all of a sudden has to process if you go, oops, what did we do and where are we at, versus, oh, 72 must be right, and just go with it. So please just make sure, you, as soon as you get that one and you got a stack of Ward 5s you need to process, just cross out the top right away, and then hopefully remember to still write that in again. But I'd rather go that route than the other route that we could have. So write the name of the last voter that was issued a ballot. That'll also help too, because, you know, if we forget to kind of go, we'll sit there and go, you know, find that last one. It'll be easier for us to find and go from there. And then just the total number of ballots processed, and then that's kind of also the same number that you wrote on there, so it's a little bit of duplicate. All right, so after the ward's been processed through the machine, and this is more of an AJ and Teresa thing than anybody else that's in that other room, they're going to want to write down the number of the last ballot that was compared to the last number tally slip. So what that sentence pretty much means is, you know, at the end of the day, we also do another double check. You guys say you counted Ward 1 and there's 72. AJ runs all those Ward 1s too in there too. He better have 72. The only exception to that is sometimes we don't want to hold up the ward, because there needs to be a couple of ballots that are remade, and maybe they're a little bit behind, or like it was November and we had, you know, a stack like that that had to be redone. But at least we'll know at that point if we're right, and then AJ will be able to say, oh, 71, and then one that needs to be remade, and we're still right. So there's our other double check. So that's why your AJ and whoever else is going to do that. So if the numbers don't match, or sorry, if the numbers match, then we can move on to the next ward. That's really easy for them to do. The machine, if you haven't looked at it, and I would encourage you all to kind of look at it when the time is a little bit slow. You know, after AJ processes every ward, there is a number there, and it clearly says 72 that have been counted. So it's really easy to know whether we need a mistake. There's also, it runs the mass count of like, oh, we ran 3,000 ballots through, but the number you easily see is how many was just processed. The beautiful thing about this machine compared to the other machines is, so say we made a mistake and we really don't know what we did. We can clear that particular ward and just start over. We don't have to completely start over. So say we just totally made a mistake on Ward 1, we don't know where we're at. Everything else is great. We can delete just the Ward 1s and rerun those through quick. So it makes it really, really nice. So if there isn't any discrepancies, or if there is a discrepancy, we got to try to figure out what happened, and this is an excellent time where, you know, maybe we don't know what happened, so we're going to just run everything through again, because what happened is, I think, a couple times they stuck two ballots together. And the machine's usually pretty good at about catching those, but it does happen. So we deleted that batch, started over, and then we ran it through again, and the numbers were right. And then when we took them apart and looked at them closer, we're like, oh yeah, I can see how those two stuck together. So that's really cool. We can do that with the old machine. Once you ran it through, you're SOL. It's only your guess on what happened. So this is really cool. That's why if you have a discrepancy, don't be afraid to say something right away. It's pretty easy for us to fix. And it could just be as simple as, like I said, the ballot stuck together, or maybe we forgot that we gave somebody to remake a ballot. So don't be afraid to fix a mistake. It's a lot easier to fix than an old system. All right, when opening and placing the ballots in the blocks, and a little bit about order, because I already said that, is just make sure you spend an extra few minutes on straightening. It makes our life a lot easier, and I don't like to harp on that, because you guys do a really good job already, but it's amazing how much a little bit of extra seconds help. All right, so something we didn't really do well in the election, and that was probably just as much my fault as, it was your fault. We'll need to do four tapes, and I know tapes isn't a good word because we actually use paper in this, so it makes our life a lot easier than if anybody has ever worked in a polling place before and realized how annoying those little strips of paper are. This prints on full 8.5 by 11 paper. It's a lot nicer, and if somehow these could print, or the polling places could print like this, it would make our life a lot easier. Last time around, we only printed one, which isn't a big deal because I have a copy machine. But what really we should do, so we're consistent, is print out four. So I'll work with the person that's closing them out. And you may wonder why I need four of them. There's a state race, which the county takes care of, so I need to give county a copy. There's a school district of, let me get ahead of myself, city council, so we need to keep a copy. There's also the school district of Janesville, which also needs a copy. And then there's a school district of Milton. So there's four of them on there, and since you guys cover all the wards, you have all four of those, so I need four copies. If you're at a polling place like library, job center, and city hall, you only really need three because you don't have Milton, but Sears is a combination of Milton and Janesville school districts. The referendum is handled by the county, so we're already supplying them with a copy for the state. If you didn't know how elections work, and I won't get into the total inner workings, anything county or state above the county takes care of, they send the results to the state, of course, but we only ever have to worry about the county. So we're going to make sure we do a better job. The machine is not programmed, and so that's something I need to update to print the number tapes you need. It's a manual process. It's really easy. It's pretty slow, though, but it's a lot faster than the old machine, but we'll have to print four copies of it on election night. And then even though it doesn't have like an affidavit, like the other ones used to have where it's signature, we'll just have to make sure that you guys sign on all those before you leave. I don't need everybody's signature, I just need an odd number of signatures. At least three, I'll take five, I'll take seven, I won't take four or six. Just seven, five, three, whatever you wanna do. As long as it's an odd number over three. All right. So here's where I did the central count time. It's gonna take place in the fourth floor of City Hall. Like I said, everything's back ready to go, looking good for you guys up there. Make sure the machines are set up right away. I don't really expect you guys to do much of the machines except for AJ and whoever ends up doing the remaking of ballots, setting up the machines ready to go. Some of you are gonna arrive at one. Some of you are gonna arrive at two. I really know people, but I don't know people's names all the time. That's a struggle for me. Don't be offended or upset that you're not gonna be scheduled at till two. I don't want you guys sitting around. I really don't want you sitting around. So like I kinda mentioned earlier, it takes about an hour. I learned that from you guys opening the ballots to getting them over there. Besides the people that I wanna know if the machines are having issues right away, you guys sit there and twiddle your thumbs. You guys got better things to do at home than family and life and everything. I don't want you guys sitting here. So don't be offended, and I just called you guys, I called them the processing team. If you get here and you don't want to spend time in that room and want to go back to opening ballots, I don't care. I just didn't want everybody sitting around doing nothing for the first hour, half the group.
Are we going to get
name tags? Name tags as far as specific or name tags just generic? Because I don't do... Okay. I can get some blank ones. I don't do specific name tags anymore. That was probably one of the worst decisions I ever made because it created a massive amount of work for me. And I'm not afraid to admit that one. It was a great idea in principle. The downside is I spent way too much time marrying them up after the election. So I can try to remember to do hi, my name is name tags for you guys. If it helps for you, I'm just, okay. And there was a complaint last time, not specifically about you, but there's a struggle of how do I know who the chief inspector is? I'll let you guys come up with ideas for that. I can buy a goofy hat or something if you would prefer. Yeah, so, no, but that does make sense. I think that's a good call. Maybe, you know, not every poll worker needs something. I mean, we give you your lanyards that have poll workers, but I think it does make sense to have chief inspectors have something on that signifies it easily, you know, like, and I'm not saying you want to go down this road, but like a neon vest or something like that, but, you know, I don't want to make something that you guys aren't comfortable in wearing or, you know, kind of cumbersome, so, you know, feel free to bring ideas up to me that will work, but yeah, I think that does make sense. I don't know if it'll happen for this election, but I do think it makes sense to have something that signifies the chief inspector's a little bit easier than what we have been doing, especially in November would have probably really been helpful, but so something that was never brought up, and the last group brought that up. So I thought that was a really good idea that I never thought of.
I commend you for your COVID precautions during all this. What COVID precautions are we going to be observing?
Yeah, I mean, that it's a tough call with you guys. You know, you guys have a little more unique position than the rest of the poll workers do. You know, COVID's obviously, you know, damaging, and I don't know whether you have COVID or don't have COVID, and you probably don't know if you have COVID or the COVID or not this COVID. Obviously, masks are required. We can have some sanitizer and stuff up there. The big difference is, you know, you're only dealing with these 30 people that you're dealing with rather than, you know, the 3,000 people that the other people are dealing with. So, you know, I first originally thought of, like, you know, do we have enough plastic shields that we could bring up? And, you know, the struggle with that is you guys are trading stuff so much back and forth. I think that might be a huge hindrance to the work that you guys do. But as of right now, it's going to be masks, we'll have gloves, we'll have sanitizer, we'll have wipes. You know, I'd encourage you guys to wipe it down as much as you can, you know, especially after each ward, maybe wiping them down. But that's what we'll have. I couldn't really come up with an easy way to, you know, do a shield with that wouldn't be really difficult to make you guys work, because you guys are trading stuff so much back and forth compared to, like, the polling place where they're just randomly, you know, sending a ballot under there. I mean, that's all back and forth. So. Well, it's up to you guys. We plan on buying you food. I would assume that it's my goal for you guys not to come in for like 3 hours like you did last time, some of you. So we're still planning on buying food. I mean, if there's a group consensus that says no, I won't be opposed to it. But I still think we plan on buying you food because you'll be here from 2 to 9, 2 to 10. I mean, that's dinner time, so I feel it's appropriate. So. Okay, so the question that was kind of raised is, don't forget that just because voting is done at 8 doesn't mean you guys are done at 8. I think the big thing that you guys have that you don't, when the polling place, when the voters last vote, they're done. They got to still do paperwork and everything. You guys have to wait until we tell you that everybody has their ballot turned in. We're going to get all the absentee ballots up to you. We're going to check the mailbox a little bit sooner so you have it maybe at like 6 and 7 and 8 rather than just waiting till 8. But, yeah, you have to wait until we call all the polling places to be sure that everyone's returned their ballot in, because somebody drops out their ballot at Sears at 7:59, we have to count it. We have to go get it. We have to scan it in, and then we can finally come back to City Hall. That's going to be at least 15, 20 minutes. So just keep in mind that just because it's 8 o'clock doesn't mean you're done. Now, on that same account, Diane, I'd also encourage you that if we're all done, with the exception of those 10 ballots, you don't need to keep everybody here. But definitely don't just leave, ask Diane, because you're going to have a better idea at 8 o'clock what to expect. I would hope by 8 you're getting 1 or 2, maybe 3 or 4, but you never know. I think last time we mistakenly brought you a lot up at 8 o'clock, which partially my fault for not checking the box earlier, because I think we brought up like 30 or 40, and that kind of surprised you. Yep. So we're going to do better checking that, and then make sure you guys just talk to Diane before you leave. All right. I don't have anything else for you today. At least I'm glad it took a half an hour up of your time. I'll get to your questions in just a second. So, but like I said, I thank you guys for everything you do, and you just made February go really, really well. And like I said, with the machine and everything, it's great. So, so your question?
My question is,
well, that's a good question. At this point, there's construction going on Milwaukee Street that you've lost all that parking. There's also construction on Main Street. construction on, and what other street did I see downtown? But anyways, I don't like this answer, but I'm gonna tell you anyways, wherever there's a spot. Don't take that wrong, I'm not trying to be rude. Okay. We don't have meters, and maybe what I can do is reach out to the police chief. We have a lot of two-hour parking right now. I know it's really important for the businesses downtown to have that parking available to them and not limit it, but maybe I can encourage him to not pursue it if it's over in the city hallway. We do have a lot that's kitty corner from city hall, that's the primary lot that I would encourage you to park in. The problem is we have workers there that are there from roughly 7:30 to 4:30 every day. Not since COVID, there's not as big as there used to be car population over there, but there's still a lot of traffic. And you know, before there's also parking available in the old bank that the downtown Janesville owns. It used to be Chase Bank. It's kind of behind City Hall. It's kind of an ugly maroon color right now. But if you're talking, if you're right behind City Hall, you're not gonna miss it. It's half, looks like it's torn down and half there, but so there is parking back there. There's also on-street parking. Like I said, the on-street parking has gotten a lot more limited with Milwaukee Street being closed. And they've also transitioned some of the all-day parking, I do believe, to two-hour parking. So, I mean, we got to do our best to be fair to the downtown businesses and allow them to have their space. That is a private lot that I can't tell you where to park or not to park there. So parking, yes, I think may be a little bit of an issue this time around, and I would encourage you, if you are working with anybody, to, I don't want to carpool nowadays because that wouldn't be appropriate either, but consider doing other options, like if your husband or your wife's not working, maybe to see if they'll be willing to drop you off and pick you up a little bit later to see, just to save on spots, because it may be of a premium a little bit. All right. We're going to reach out to the people, and probably just to make things easier for us, we're going to say, we're going to call you if you're going to be here at 2. That way I only got to call half the people. So if we don't call you, report at 1. If we call you, report at 2. And if for some reason you don't get a call or you don't get the message, you'll just come in at 1 because you won't know any different. So I'll tell Mary. Mary, we'll all reach out to you, and we'll figure out what exactly we are. So if we don't call you, come in at 1. If we call you, come in at 2. You can come in at 1. I'll let you know right now. So I spent a little more time with you than I did last time, so I guess that's good. You guys have any more questions? Yes, it does keep getting better and better each time, and I think each time we learn something and we change things along the way, it'll get a lot better. Like I said, without the DS450, we would be in trouble, I think, on a lot of these things. I absolutely love that machine. It's the best thing that we've gotten in a long time for an election, in my opinion. But yeah, like I said, everything has been getting better and better, but if you guys have ideas for improvements, don't be ever hesitant to let me know what's going on. Election day may not be a good day, but I can give you my business card and you can follow up with me after election day. And I'll definitely have time to chit-chat about things. And like I said, hopefully, knock on wood, this is the last election till February, because I don't know about you, but I'm ready for an election break. Pending anything. You know how that goes, though. With the current political climate, nothing's off limit, I would say. Question? Okay. Sure. And you guys, like I said, are in a little more unique situation than the rest of the polling places, you know, but I'll definitely, you know, buy you the temporary ones. I'm not going to go down the road where you have permanent ones like I did the last time. And so, yeah, definitely I can do my name is, stuff like that, and you guys can fill it out. I have no problem with that. I'm hoping somehow I can make it look a little more professional than just my name is thing, but we may have to go with that in February or in April, so because it's not a whole lot of time. I think I can still get it from Staples if I order them today. But yeah, I agree. Good question. Do I expect observers? I don't know. I won't lie. We usually don't ever have observers unless it's a November election. Like I said, most of you have been voting for a lot longer than I have, but with this current political climate, I don't think anything's off limits. And sometimes with local races, especially like city council, school board, sometimes you get observers because they have a better idea when our central count comes out of where it's at. Because, you know, we're the majority of, there's obviously other townships and whatever villages that vote for the school or school board, but you know, the vote's gonna be decided by Janesville, pretty much. So there's sometimes I see observers, but I usually only see observers too when it comes to county races, sometimes like county board supervisors, because it's a lot more ward specific. So I can go to, let's just say, First Lutheran, and I know if I'm gonna win re-election pretty much because it's gonna be determined by that one polling place. But nothing would surprise me at this election if we have observers. I would be shocked though if we have more than a couple. All right, you guys have a good day. If you don't have any more questions, have a good Easter. Hopefully you guys can enjoy time with your family before you get to enjoy time with your other family on Tuesday. All right, thank you guys.